Winston Salem, what's happening? It is your boy Bugatti, the host, and we are back with episode 14 of Pink Talk Podcast. First off, I want to shout out Open Media Lab for allowing us to record here. Shout out Miss Faith. She couldn't be here today. She's getting that money. Y'all make sure y'all follow my partner, Coldplay Wu, who left me hanging today and got me here dolo, but that's okay. And we got a special guest in the building with us today. We got Kindred Spirits of Winston-Salem. Got my man R.J. Got the lovely Antonina here.
What's up?
All right. First, we're going to talk about Kindred Spirits. I did follow your IG. You know, I looked through it, and I do have a lot of questions today.
Love questions. We live for questions.
Did his homework.
Yeah, I did my homework.
We really like those people.
Yes. So, first, we're going to start off with telling us, what is Kindred Spirit?
You want me to answer that question?
You want to take it?
Oh, sure. Ooh. Kindred Spirits has been around. This is our 26th year in business.
Yeah,
26 Downtown years. Downtown 26 years. It was originally founded in 1994 by Howard and Linda Fawley. They were part of a Hare Krishna community. And Kindred Spirits in that era was a lot to do with their faith and culture around that piece of spirituality. And in 2012, I purchased the business and became the owner. And then RJ became my co-owner this past fall, I guess last fall. And what Kindred Spirits does is that we exist to serve our community, and that takes many shapes and forms. And it's always been a place where people have come to seek spiritual answers. That's just what that store is there for. Okay. So we have had quite an adventure with that over the years. We sell retail, like brick and mortar product. So we sell things like crystals and gemstones and jewelry and tarot decks and kind of all the stuff that fits into that spiritual interest realm of things, books about the chakras. We also sell like fine artwork from local creators.
Indeed.
And we sell herbal medicine, and we also provide services by local healers, readers, and shamans.
Okay.
So that's what we do. We do the services and we provide the product, and like 90% of it is made by local people.
Okay. Pretty cool.
Indeed, yeah.
Pretty cool.
So all things metaphysical and spiritual, essentially. Okay. We've been that hub. So it's very cross-sectional as well. Like our communities are very broad and diverse from all paths and religions and spiritualities. And so it's kind of the safe space where spiritual development is like our core focus. We're meeting people where they are on their journey of awareness and assisting them in clarifying that discernment and their connection with the divine, however that's manifesting for them there. And so,
okay,
yeah, that metaphysical. We're those folks.
Okay. how did you guys link up? Being that the place has been in existence for so long,
yeah,
and you know, you just kind of coming on board. But how did y'all link up?
Yeah, not just
been here for a minute.
Oh, so you've been here for a minute, yeah. But you just recently purchased.
Indeed,
as a partner.
Yeah.
Okay,
so
I got
I've known
you.
Antonina. I met Antonina in 2014. Yeah. So about 6 years now, sort of saying. There was a psychic skills development workshop that she was doing.
Okay.
And I was like, I snuck into it on that there and really just, because I snuck into the workshop and I met with Antonina, and I was there for the workshop, and we had some pretty profound experiences take place while being that evening. And I remember after, like later that week, I emailed her. I was like, hey, like, what's next? Like, literally, like, what can I do to plug in and kind of keep this momentum going? And she was like, well, you're welcome to come to the shop anytime, you know, and I'll keep you posted for anything. And so from there, I started kind of hanging around and kind of coming around from time to time. And a friendship began to kind of bud from there.
Okay.
And then some years later, there was a juncture. Kindred just kept coming up on my heart and on my spirit, like, strongly. And I remember it was the new moon of October 2014, and it was like, hey, like, you need to get in the door somehow. And
okay.
I think that evening, I kid you not, like, hours later, there was a newsletter from Kindred, which Antonina was sending the newsletters at that time, but there's a newsletter which came out which said, hey, looking for a tarot reader and cashier. And I was like, there's my fucking in. I emailed her. I was like, hey, I've never read tarot, but I bought a deck from your store and I have cashier experience. I'd like to interview. And she accepted my request to interview, and I interviewed. And
he showed up. He was the first interviewee.
I was the first.
He was there at the door 15 minutes before his interview. I know, because I was there a half hour before. Just kind of like, you know, chilling at my store, trying to make a big decision about hiring somebody. And then he came in. He was, like, wearing, like, his little, like, you know, button-down interview shirt. And he had gotten, like, obviously some shaving done. I was like, look at him. He's prepared.
So he came dressed to impress.
He did. He had his little resume printed out and everything. Yeah. I'm not trying to, like, infantile you, but he was so sweet. He was younger. I mean, gosh, how old are you? You were 24 or something.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, oh, gosh, even 20, younger.
23?
Like, yeah,
I was
like
22. Wow. Oh, my gosh, 22.
So you guys known each other for quite a while. You got bonded.
Yeah.
But you just recently.
We've been through some things, actually.
So y'all just recently became business partners.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As far as our ownership.
Yeah, I guess RJ, like, when he started working as a tarot reader, he worked doing that for, I guess, like 6 months or something. And then he kept, like, pestering me to be my apprentice. And I eventually decided to trust him. And then it was the best decision I ever made. And then, like, within the year, he was managing the store. And I, like, was taking out loans to hire him to be my manager so I could step away and try to figure out what we were going to do with Kindred. And he, like, was pivotal for everything we've done, our online web store, all of the his big first project was all the labels on the herbs. So if you go up to every herb canister in the store, It has the name of the herb, and it has, like, its magical properties and it has its healing properties, so you can just look at it. It's all alphabetical. Uh-huh. And I made him design that was his first test.
Okay.
And then we rebooted our store and, like, put all sorts of new displays in. And so he's helped me, like, completely revamp it from the inside out, from the top to the bottom.
I remember noticing, like, one of the biggest first thing. I was like, okay, to get through to Antonina, like, you need to be useful in some way. So I was like, okay. Like, she's not responding to me just asking, kind of, you know. I was like, okay, what can I provide to her? So my background originally is in creative marketing.
Okay.
And tech. And so I was like, okay, I'm going to offer her all of my services, for, like, essentially, like, taking Kindred on as a brand.
So you knew what you wanted to do with Kindred's
Right, first. Right. I was like, okay, like, Kindred needs a refresh, a reboot, and a rebrand. That's exactly what I do for businesses at the time. That's what I was coming from. And I was like, okay, well, let me do that for you, pro bono.
Okay.
If you let me apprentice you.
Yeah, and she was like, the apprenticeship is sort of the next
step. Yeah, and then she was like, okay.
Pretty cool. Mm. So tell the world where they can, how they can get in contact with you. For Kindred Spirits, plug in your IG and give them the address.
Why don't you do that?
Yeah, and so you can definitely connect with this on IG at kindredspirits_WS. If you're on right now, you're here. But at kindredspirits_WS. On Facebook, it's Kindred Spirits, and you can our logo is the infinity symbol there. So you can find us on Facebook. Those are going to be the two best places to connect with us there. And if you're local, come through, check us out online. It's www.kindredspirits.ws, as in Winston Salem.
All right, so y'all make sure y'all go follow, or if you're in the area, make sure you stop in.
Yeah, and we're on Trade Street. 537A North Trade Street, not far from here.
Yeah,
okay.
We're
they're right around the corner.
Yeah,
I think I'm about to go over there. Though. Stop by Downtown Bodega when I leave here.
Oh, right around the corner. Yeah, my gosh, I'm waiting for the sea moss and mango to come back. That's my joint.
So, your experience as a tarot card reader.
Yeah.
Give me some of your experiences.
Yeah, totally. So, like I said, when I first started my very non-traditional entrance into reading in general, Antonio at my interview was the first person I'd ever read tarot for.
Uh-huh.
I grew up in a, it was very much discouraged to entertain anything close to that realm of work. And so, my background's in the church. I was raised and born in ministry, active in ministry, the whole gamut, worship pastor and things of that nature there. And so I was grateful to have gotten acquainted with kind of the gifts of ministry, which do involve a certain level of spiritual sensitivity.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess reading or discerning was definitely something I've been doing all my life. And tarot, I found, was introduced for me as more so a tool to refine that sense of intuition and to find that sense of discernment. And so it's always interesting when reading with someone because it can it can be somewhat of an intimate exchange of sorts there, being able or having a moment where you're kind of unpacking things which appear to be unseen in a way.
Okay.
So it's different every time, but it's very communal. It's very much, it's ceremony every time. And it's helped me, and it's helped, I'm grateful to have, you know, been able to lend that support and help. Because sometimes you just really need to know what's up. Like, it's like, hey, like, I know what I know, but I don't know what I don't know.
Yeah.
And so tarot and divination in general is a way to kind of divine or discern the, it's like solving for X in a way. It's like, hey, what's the variable?
So okay.
I use tarot.
So it's like a big equation.
Right, basically. Right. Yeah, life.
All right. Trying to live it. So, like, as far as, you know, how does a person that's interested with getting a tarot reading, like, you know, what are some of the things that are going through a person's mind that makes them say, hey, I think I need to get a tarot
reading? Oh, my gosh. Usually a problem of some sorts. You know, usually it's a lover situation or a financial situation, I will say.
We don't get that at all. We get that this all. Is why we send people to different readers, because they're like, everybody you could possibly imagine with every possible scenario you could ever imagine has come to get a reading. But eventually what happens is people start getting really good at certain energy streams. And RJ's always getting the ladies who have the love questions.
Oh my gosh, yeah, love work.
Court work, too.
Court work, yeah. Love, yeah, love situation, court situation. Finances. Hey, like, I got this coming up. I need to know, like, what am I expecting and, like, how can I work with it? And, like, for me, at this point, like, reading in general is a part of the work that I do. It's very much like first base, like checking. It's like the diagnosis, going to the doctor, like, hey, like, what are we actually dealing with here? And so usually some type of problem, some type of concern that, and a need for clarity is what gets people into a reading of sorts. Tarot is one way to do it. We offer several modes of operation. There's mediumship, which is more so connecting and contacting spirits to kind of interact or bring information in that way, more of a spiritual reading.
I feel like mediumship, though, is definitely you're talking to a dead person.
Absolutely. Definitely.
So of the there deceased. Are other spirits one can speak to as well that are not necessarily dead people. So I just want to put that out there.
True.
Okay. Because
there's a whole shamanism piece, too.
There is
another
that.
Layer. So I'm just going to interject details. Like, I'm the reference at the bottom of your encyclopedia. So you go back.
Yeah, and so there are levels to this shit, for real. Tarot is definitely is great for kind of those, the situational and energetics. It's like, okay, let's just like take a look at... I tell people often at the beginning of a reading, when I'm reading for anyone for the first time, I let them know I don't consider tarot to be fortune-telling in the least.
Okay.
It's very much... like energetic forecasting, the same way we would check the weather to kind of see like how like a low pressure system is affecting.
Kind of like such. a directional thing.
Exactly,
like a directional guidance. Kind of like you need to kind of go this way, or you need to kind of go
right. Right. It's like, yeah, given how the energy is flowing, this is what you can expect. Like, either you need your umbrella today or you don't.
There are only so many variables that could possibly come up. There's 78 cards, and however they come together in a story, it becomes pretty clear, too, like, what things are going on. And then if people are disbelieving, you just keep pulling cards on top of them until they see the card that makes them finally get what you're trying to say to them.
Yeah.
Some people are often in disbelief because they are coming for, like, really sensitive topics, their love life or finances or court. So a lot of people don't want real talk answers, and that's what we used to deal with back in the day.
Yeah,
but now people just know. Yeah. Don't even.
So
go
somebody's
by
coming,
there.
And they might get a tarot reading. Your boyfriend's cheating on you with the next door neighbor, and you're gonna be broke next week. This kind of that.
This has happened before.
And now, you know, but they're expecting the most, and they might end up getting the worst.
Well, yeah, it's kinda. Usually the hopeful, sweet, younger kind of, or even older love. It's always sad when there's people in love and they want you to read some sort of discernment
couples
about their
readings,
partner.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it's like, oh.
I tell people, like, don't come to me. I'm going to read it as it is.
Yeah. Okay.
As it is. And so, like, we're very much kindred. We're very much, like I said, solution oriented in a way. It's like there's nothing. And honestly, contrary to popular belief, while we might be categorized as like new age industry in the minds of, you know, many, we're pretty much anti new age. Like, we're very much real, like, grounded, down to earth people who believe that it's important to integrate the spirit into this living of life. And
we
help people
from family cultures and heritages that celebrate it.
Now, as far as with your tarot card reading, have you ever had a situation where somebody that you've read, you know, did their reading and they came back at you, you know, just like, hey, man, hey, this shit was totally the opposite of what you told me. And, you know, just like real aggressive about.
Never aggressive.
I've literally never had that happen.
I've never had that happen.
I've never.
The only time I've had the opposite occasion is actually on, it was actually in like a couple situation. And like we were looking at a couple of things and the energy that was coming through for one person had gotten flopped and it was coming through for the different, for the second person. But they had a couple of people going on anyway.
Okay.
But yeah, but never an aggressive follow up was like, oh no, what you told me was a lot of the other types.
Oh my gosh, yeah.
I can't believe like then, shit, can we do it again?
You get scared of those people and you're like, nah, you've had enough. Had enough.
Yeah,
like,
do the work. Yeah.
Don't come back for another chase.
Right.
Okay. I know it's not good for business, but some people get too dependent. Like you know,
can.
We've had those ladies who come in like every single week asking for the same question to be answered. And you're like, look, we told you once he's cheating on you with the next door neighbor. But please.
Have you ever had a situation where somebody guys came to you for spiritual guidance and it was something that you felt like you may had to reach out to somebody, you know, because this may be something that could be, you know, life threatening.
Yeah. And Antonina's my go-to person for that there. I tag Antonina in for all of the.
We've gotten pulled into some scenarios.
Oh my gosh.
We could... Both by other people and just by existing in reality. But yeah, we have many harrowing adventures with many twists and turns and interesting characters involved. Cops and police and people almost dying and stabbing like we're, and all sorts of crazy stuff has happened.
and with something like that, do you guys have a level of confidentiality that you that you either can exceed or you know that's directional that you may like this is not something that I may have to get the authorities involved in or something that you definitely know. But hey, I need to see somebody about this immediately.
Right. There's definitely
instinct is most of that.
Yeah,
you know?
It's very intuitive there, and this is a very sacred work. We hold it very sacred as well, and so like the you know holding confidence is very much a real thing. And I mean, it's a consultative service as well. It's like okay, like you know, you're coming in for this. Like what you do with it as you you know depart. You know that's on you, but situations which require additional support or additional members brought in on it. That is a thing, but it's instinctive, I would
say. Yeah, I mean, sometimes people come for the healing knowing that they need that level of help.
Yeah.
And then there are people who come into our existence as kindred spirits as more part of our shamanic lineage, which is more like a hoop of people that we provide shamanic work for, much like a priest or clergy person would, which is more of a life spiritual path that also comes from traditions and heritage. So we have people come in sometimes where you know you're teaching them or helping them or giving them readings or teaching them about their gifts, and you may even be seeing things unfold for them that are not well, but that's not your relationship as a medicine person or as a shaman to like
step
be in their
it.
Space
yeah.
with them like that. So every person is incredibly unique. They come for whatever reason that they come for, and you're there on their journey for whatever reason that is, literally part of their spiritual experience. And then you're also just you. And so the most strange thing about kindred spirits is I've been there, I guess, for 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
RJ's been there for almost 6 years, and we've been behind the counter for like the entire time. So like this is every single day of our lives.
Yeah.
So after a while, you know, so you put in your hours, you start to really understand how all of these systems work. But not everybody coming in does. We find that a lot of people who come in to experience kindred spirits for whatever reason are called there, for whatever reason they are. And then it's part of our discernment to decide, does this person engage with us in a way that's appropriate or don't they? And what level of engagement can I have with that person?
Yeah.
And it's not always about business, to be really honest with you.
Yeah.
I mean, most of kindred is truly charity. It's just the charity of our lives. It's like
it's
we're just, yeah, we just do this work because we care. We know it's important. We know there are people out there having bizarre experiences.
Okay.
And we want to be able to help them. And we also know that we, as people who are having bizarre experiences, know what it's like to go through that. And to hold all that knowledge about What is it like when you start to see a spirit, or you think your ancestor is talking to you, or your house is haunted, or something weird starts following you around, or you swear you can see a shadow in the corner? Mm. Our favorite line at Kindred when people come in is, so I have something kind of weird. I have a weird question, or I have something really strange happen to me. And we're like, what level of strange?
Try.
Like, are we talking Ghostbusters level?
You guys get a lot of different personalities.
Oh my gosh.
I could only imagine.
Oh yes, you really truly can only.
And if somebody was wanting to get a tarot card reading, what does a tarot card reading start at?
Oh, like price wise?
Yes.
Oh, it's $1 a minute. So you come into the store, you make an appointment online, you want a 15-minute reading, $15. We think our rate's incredibly reasonable, especially if you're looking at Charlotte prices.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, that's something that I always, you know, as far as from when me growing up, you know, the most popular tarot card reader, Miss Cleo.
Yeah.
Just listening to someone who actually does it. And it's been there for a while. It's very interesting.
Yeah, it's a diagnostic tool, like the tarot is. Like we're actually going to be doing a series of we call them tarot talks, and they're going to be virtual meetups with those who are interested in learning about the tarot as a form of reading and wanting to become a reader. And we're going to, you know, help kind of explain and demystify like what tarot is and how it can be used to support one's intuition. But yeah, like I tell people often, and we tell them in our meetups and in our classes and courses, like there is nothing special necessarily about the cards.
Except for my tarot deck, and everything is special about the cards. Right, every card is special. I just finished drawing every single card. I've been working on it
for
2.5 years. There's 78 cards, and just 2 days ago, I finished.
And you hand drew every card.
Hand drew every card.
Wow, wow. Let's give a shout out to Antonina.
Indeed, it's a big
for
work,
drawing out her 70. You said 78.
It's 78 cards.
78 tarot cards that she's been working on for 2 years. From scratch.
Yeah.
I started February 12th, 2018.
That's great. And y'all make sure y'all follow Kindred Spirits on IG at KindredSpirits_WS. And y'all make sure y'all follow us on Pink Talk Podcast at Pink Talk_Podcast on IG. Man, we are in here. We are vibing.
Yeah.
Like, the energy is definitely in here. I mean, I'm serious. The energy is definitely in here. It's good conversation.
I love the energy. Like, it's a vibe. Yeah, it is a vibe.
Sunset vibe.
Right, though. Sunset in the open lab.
So, as far as spirituality, like, what is you guys, you know, as far as a religion background? Do you guys have a religion background that you follow, or, you know?
I'll tell a tale.
Okay.
So I was raised Roman Catholic.
Okay.
My mother is second generation Holocaust survivor. Her mother was in the Siberian Holocaust in the 1930s and was put in a camp and survived and was a refugee and made it to America.
Okay.
And when she was over as a refugee in India, she tried to join the Catholic Church. She wanted to be a nun.
Okay.
But she had gone deaf in one of her ears because she had diphtheria. And the church would not take her because she couldn't hear the church bells through her wimple. So this is a little head covering thing. Mm. So they sent her here to America. And along with her, there were several other girls. And one of the other ones just recently passed. She was a nun in the Catholic Church. So my sister is a Catholic nun right now.
Okay.
So my sister Becky, or mother, what is it? Sister Maria Josepha.
Gotcha.
She's a Benedictine nun. And I was raised Roman Catholic, and I still practice Catholicism to some degree. I don't know how to explain it to you. If you want to talk about theology, I have a degree in philosophy, and I could explain how everything I believe is exactly what other Catholic people believe. But none of them believe that in right. the official sense. I've got some friends who are priests. I've got some friends who are nuns. I still go to the churches. Like, I literally bring people sometimes to the Catholic Church to get healings done from priests.
Okay.
That I'm just like, I'm not messing with that. Like, okay. You've got the church behind
you.
You
need Jesus. Sometimes you just.
You do. Sometimes you really do need that. You want Jesus and holy water and anointing oils, and you need it to be some Catholic priest calling on the communion of saints under the authority of the church. But, you know, I've, like, brought people to church with me. Like, there have been people who I'm sitting down to do a reading of them, and their, like, ancestor comes in, and they're like, she needs to go to Catholic Mass. And I'm like, gosh. And I tell the person that, and they're, like, crying. And they're like, but I don't want to go alone. And I'm like, but really, nobody does. Does this mean I have to go with them? And it always means that I have to go with them.
Yeah.
But I went to St. Leo's here in town.
Okay.
Yeah, it's right down in the Buena Vista area. I went there kindergarten.
I'm not familiar with it, but I'm familiar with the Buena Vista area. My aunt lives over there.
I got in trouble a lot, guys. My socks weren't tall enough. My school uniforms got too dirty. I was called to the principal's office for that.
Oh, yeah, they don't play about that. I went to Catholic middle school because I got kicked out of public school.
Oh, word.
Then I went to a Catholic high school I got kicked out of there. I had to go back to public school.
So you used it as punishment.
Yeah.
I mean, they
tie and, ain't no swagging it out.
No fond memories. I mean, I have beautiful memories and experiences within the culture of Catholicism and, like, the saints, which we bond over quite a bit, and the traditions that he's practicing. I love the artwork and the experiences with all of that growing up, the nostalgia and the frankincense and the myrrh and the praying. I've prayed a lot, by the way. Mm. My parents used to make us pray the rosary every single night. And some long litanies did during the summers, too.
You'll repent.
Look, I know how to pray.
I'm quite familiar with that. Yeah.
Yes.
So as far as kindred spirits, you know, some people might, you know, not be so comfortable coming in, or, you know, I'm pretty sure you see those people.
They just don't come in.
What for someone who wants to have their household, you know, I guess divine.
Yeah.
What products can they purchase from Kindred Spirits that they can get home, you know, take home and refresh their home?
Yeah. So when we get into talking about people's, like, spiritual ecosystems, I like to have a disclaimer that there are things that people think are really beneficial for their spaces, like frankincense and myrrh and sage and things like that, or crystals. But you need to remember, too, that, like, some people really do have, like, entities and attachments or ancestral stuff going on, and all that can make it feel like their house feels a certain way, or it could be the feng shui or whatever. So there's all manner of things. If you went onto our website and you looked through our products, you might see something that calls to you that feels right. But I feel like until people communicate with us, we can't give them, like, a whole blanket statement like that's going to be good for your house, because it could disrupt something.
Okay.
And they might not even know it. I mean, if you can't sense these things, you can know that something's off, but you will have no idea. I mean, it's not all wrong what people think and believe, that these things are sensitive and that these things can create manifestations of difficulties within your life when you go in contact with them. But that's sort of like the whole process of unveiling what the truth of reality is to you spiritually. And that could mean that you need to remove an entity, or it could also mean that you don't want to offend one of your ancestors by bringing in the wrong stone.
And there's an exact story which I can think of, which when that happened for someone, we had, she came in and I think she, like, you know, coerced her husband into coming in with her, and they wanted something for their home, and they ended up purchasing, like, she was doing all manner of, like, spiritual development. She was just getting into it, ancestral work in particular, contacting and connecting with her ancestors. And she came in and she got a statue of Buddha. She's like, oh, this would be nice for my altar. And, like, you know, I'm getting started, and I'm going to get this Buddha statue and some sage, and I'm going to kind of get started. She ended up coming back into the store, like, a few months later, and she brought the Buddha back with her. She was like, something's wrong with it. Like, something's wrong with it. Like, I've experimented with it. Like, when it is in our home, like, nothing is going right. Like, my relationship goes to shit. Like, the whole vibe just changes. Something's wrong with the Buddha. And obviously, I know that there's nothing wrong with the Buddha. But I was like, okay, like, let us see. Like, obviously, similar to reading tarot, you can read objects as well. And I was like, okay, let us sit with it. We'll see what's actually going on. Turns out, in the ancestral work she was doing, like, her ancestors were not cool with Buddha.
We've had a lot of people tell us that.
I've heard something similar. Like, if you have, it's like, you have to have it placed in a certain spot.
There is a nuance to it, for sure, which, like Antony was saying, can make things go awry. But for her in particular, she had the ancestors which she was working with, and it showed up for her most prevalently, were hyper-Christian. They were hyper-Christian in life, and they were still very much in that frame of thinking in their afterlife. And so she was calling them into her space, and they were like, yo, we don't want to be, like, you were... Like, we don't want to be in this. Like, this is not right. And so end
that's
up...
That's not what they signed up for when they signed up for the gates of Jesus' kingdom.
Wow.
Yeah, so don't call them in.
Yeah, and so we were able to kind of help her work through... Because and we talk about this in terms of working with ancestors. All ancestors are not good ancestors, and you don't want to work with all of them.
But like, people call them good medicine ancestors and bad medicine ancestors. Exactly. It's not... medicine if it's bad.
It's right.
I'm sorry. I know people want to like split hairs over philosophy, and this is what happens in the spiritual communities it's like tomato, people just literally come at you for like not describing or defining your terms all the time. So if you're wondering like, why does she have to explain everything? Because someone will come after me online and I'm just preparing to deal with them.
Yeah.
Yes. We even had it happen today, and it wasn't even about anything spiritual. I was just trying to find out who I should paint on some legs. It's a completely different story. RJ, take this somewhere else.
So, yeah, there is nuance. And so in getting into it, it is encouraged to consult, to find someone who is knowledgeable in whatever path that you're beginning to work within, because paths do differ. Like it was, I guess Kindred Spirits exists as kind of a centralized hub for many paths.
Okay.
Antonina's path that she was just sharing very much is connected through and stemmed from a Roman Catholic and kind of indigenous Ukrainian kind of Eastern European.
Siberian Holocaust.
Yeah, it's that. It's
it
that
really vibe. Is.
And there is a whole cosmology spiritually which comes from that. I come from a Central West African lineage out of Benin and Mali. And so voodoo is the spiritual practice which my ancestors practice and which I have taken up and practice today. And so also has a cosmology which differs, but there are points of similarity, one of which being the saints. We see the saints a lot in the Roman Catholic practice, obviously, but within Vodou, like, you know, the saints are very much like that you work with saints often, and they're representative of many of the spiritual forces which, are used to affect change within our lives. Okay. And so it's finding your path and then finding someone who's on that path is it highly advised so that you don't screw yourself up.
Before we get to the voodoo, I got one more question for you. do you guys have like a little checklist, you know, to kind of go through with someone to know what type of things they should have or should not have based on their background?
Not exactly a checklist.
Usually we wait for some spirit to magically appear next to them and like whisper the secrets into our ears while they think that we're just magically reading their minds.
Yeah, there's that. Like it's highly discerned. It's a case by case thing for each person, because each person comes with a different, like each person has a spiritual court, like their ancestors and the spirits which are with them. And so it's so key to listen to. Because literally, like when you're alive and you're a person and you're trying to say, hey, I'm trying to develop spiritually, that's going to link you into all of the spirits which you're working with. And so you don't have to just consider what a person is trying to develop spiritually, but the spirits and the spiritual lineage that they come from. It's like, okay, so it's like bringing your car into the shop. It's like, hey, this is what's wrong. Like, this is what's not working. But
don't
like,
put
okay,
a Toyota and a Ford together.
Yeah, and you can't take your BMW to Ford for
cannot.
And so, so it's like, you know, making sure that, and the first thing they do when you get your car is, hey, like, we'll put it up, let's get it up in the air, let's open it up and see what we're working with. It's the same thing spiritually.
Okay.
That there.
My favorite is when people walk up to you and say, what color is my aura?
Oh, yeah, read me.
What's my aura look like? And you're just standing behind the counter. It looks dark. We do that, actually, sometimes. It just depends on who the person is.
Okay.
Once some kids came in and asked me if I bought people's souls.
Wow, yeah.
They did. I think they were really high.
I had people come in like wanting to sell, so willing to sell their souls.
What
like,
does that even
young
mean?
Artists, I get so many young artists which are like, which really think so, that that's their way. Like,
so they to, think to, like y'all Illuminati kind of
look,
situation.
That came up today. Someone accused me. And I was just like, I'm not even talking about this. Too weird. I'm not going to conspiracy theory up on here.
I was like, you want your mixtape to blow up? Like, you don't need to. Don't sell your soul to anyone. For that. You don't. Let's
you
talk
just need
about
to work hard, man.
Right.
Work
right.
hard. Promote like, yourself. Hard
you need to be talking to God if you're at that level. Just yeah. stop coming into Kindred and start getting on
but
your
people
knees.
Do think that, yeah, you know. But, you know.
So as far as you're practicing a voodoo, you know, everybody thinks of voodoo as a negative, you know, or
yeah.
something that you... doing to harm someone.
Right.
Like, what are your experiences on a positive outcome from your practice of voodoo?
Yeah.
That you care to share?
For sure. Well, I think to debunk the misconception around voodoo being negative, which is a very Western crafted perception of it. Voodoo and the word itself, voodoo, it means to be in balance and in harmony with life. And so it's very much, I guess, out of the, I guess, Western mindset of kind of hyper-moralized, good, bad, you know, all love and light, it should be all good. Voodoo understands that it's not, life is life. It has good and bad. It has positive and negative forces. You want to be in balance with those forces and work with them, especially if you're needing certain changes. So positively, like, voodoo is life. And so the very life force energy which sustains us all is the divinity which is being tapped into when practicing voodoo. And so it's very much not as it seems. I think
it's part
Hollywood
of its magic,
is,
though, is yeah, that it's not as it seems.
It's not as it seems.
That's a bit, great way to protect your
I was
going
to ask you to show me how to bury my girl drawers in the backyard and she can't leave the house or something.
Right, right. Nah.
But I mean, why would you want to do that?
That's conjure for you.
That's some conjure. That's
joking. Well, yeah.
But, and that's the thing to note as well. I guess voodoo being kind of the central West African, you know, spirituality, it is the shamanism of central West Africa.
Okay.
As it moved, obviously, transatlantic slave trade brought, you know, a lot of, you know, those priests, those mambos, those ungans, like, they brought them here to the Americas, and now, obviously, Christianity was the first thing that they encountered. And so I think a core tenet of voodoo as a practice as well, and as a religion, is that it's hyper-inclusive. It is not, it has and it's needed to include and incorporate everything.
And that's what really makes it shamanism, because like the people of Siberia and Northern Russia, where the word shaman comes from, that was referring to like a certain group of people who were born other that had these gifts and were known to be every generation or ever however many generations be born to like work with the spirit world, which up in like the taiga, it was just like this giant, deep forest built. Sub-freezing temperatures you may need to live or survive for generations and generations and generations and then pass that down to someone else. So they were in like the trade route of the Silk Road. And so like one religion would come after another, and everyone wants to convert you. So eventually these shamans just started to learn how to incorporate everything because there must be truth within all of it. And that's how you can be in relationship with the spirits.
Absolutely.
And so a lot of people get mad at shamans because they're like, well, why do you speak to spirits? Because you literally hear people here in the South on these Bible Belt channels telling you, like, I listened to this the other day. Some guy who was telling a woman that the reason things were wrong in her life were because her Mormon friend was praying for her. And that Mormon friend only prays to the God of Mormonism. And I was like, which would be the same God. Okay, so this is the kind of stuff, you know, like all this weird cultural stuff we're still moving through.
Okay.
And it's like, why are they mad that we are just born with the ability to see and speak to and hear these spirits? Like, it's not like I asked to exist like this.
Yeah, it's kind of,
And that's what usually gets people upset. It's like, well, how can you do that and believe in Jesus? It's just
right.
Like, I think he was talking to the spirits too. Like, have you ever read through his work there?
Right.
I was like, I've paid attention because I was looking for some guidance. I was like, this guy,
don't we all, that's how
he
we all
was
find
seeing
Jesus.
Something.
That's why I love Jesus.
Right.
And people really look at us sideways when we say that. And
right.
We mean it full hearted.
They think we're being sarcastic or
no,
like
past Satanists.
I mean,
we're not.
Me personally, you know, I had an experience when I was locked up. You know,
you don't say when you were locked up. Okay, yes. We get a lot of calls about these types of things.
And so while I was in there, I read My Daily Bread. And I was like, there's no way every day I can read something I feel like it applies directly to me. And it, and my, you know, and that, that really made me, my connection with, with God, like that much stronger.
Yeah.
I mean, I already had a connection with God, but just to actually read something every single day and every single passage you read applied directly to
message.
You.
That was a message.
Yeah, the power of devotion. That's, that's definitely a way to tap in for sure, for sure.
Yeah, I guess maybe that's something else maybe people are jealous of. Is that you, like, have this relationship to God that feels so direct? Like, why is God showing you that? Or why is God sending you those messages? And I'm like, because if they did not, I do not know how I would exist in this reality. Like, I literally do not know. Like, I've been taking cues for a minute to learn how to trust people.
Yeah.
You know, like, to know if someone's on my side or not. To know whether or not I'm supposed to be talking to a person if someone's got ill will towards me. Yeah. I have gotten out of some very dangerous situations before.
Like, Yeah. Like, there's a protection that comes from it. And it's also, I think it gets discounted, like, the trial and tribulation. Like,
initiations. Initiation, people get mad at us for
like,
that, too.
And you don't want, if you don't want to, you know, go through that, then it's like, literally, like, there is no, like, everything comes with the cost, like, and it's, that's also like, you know, a core tenet. Well, shamanism, I guess, in a way is.
I guess it looks like the Illuminati from the outside.
I mean, it's a matter of bargaining. You don't, you never get something for nothing,
right?
And with much, to whom much is given, much is required. And so there's that aspect too. Okay. It's not always obviously. It's great to get to a point where you've, you know, had your shit fucked up enough where you can, you know, unfuck it quickly. But
right,
it's like, yeah, I'm like, no, I'm like. I had to go through shit.
Like, you had to have your back against the wall.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, you had to...
Perpetually. That was actually my shamanic death experience there. Like, yeah, it was like, it just kept blowing up. It kept blowing up. And that's commonly one of the ways which spirits will get you or nudge you onto your path is literally when spirits begin to initiate you, they're going to begin to affect your life. Because like I said, like, you are a living being who is trying to connect with your spiritual lineage. And so it's an invitation for them to join you in life. And they're like, okay. And that's why we see all types of bizarre things, because it really is bizarre.
Wow.
It really is bizarre.
That, man, you guys, y'all go through a lot. All right, just from being here for this hour, and we really ain't go to your day to day. You know, we're just getting to know what Kindred Spirits is.
Look, people around here on the streets, they know what Kindred Spirits is, and they know what we do. And they may know that we've gotten them in or out of jail a few times or prison a few times or whatever. Or maybe we're the first place they come on the way out. So, totally, I mean, we're good in the hood. Like, people know where we are, how to get in touch with us. And if they don't, that's okay, too.
Well, we're going to tell them right now. So, all my followers, if you want to get in touch with your spiritual side, y'all make sure y'all follow Kindred Spirits _WS on IG. And they will get you right. Y'all get you on the right path. And they'll get you moving. It's so interesting. We could keep going and keep going. But
you need to have RJ back.
Our time, you know, we got an hour.
That was a quick hour. Yeah.
We talk a lot.
Yeah, I mean, no, that's how it's supposed to flow. We got 8 minutes.
Yeah.
So nice.
We still got. Gotcha. So from this point moving forward, what direction or what is your next step with Kindred Spirits?
Oh, wow. We have some big releases coming. We're about to drop some major information.
Yeah, about to share from the vaults.
Yes.
The crypt.
We've been working on a lot of stuff for a long time, and we're very good at working slowly but arduously and very persistently on projects. And so not only do we have this tarot deck that we're about to publish, so we published just the major arcana last December, and we sold out of all of the decks. It was 51 decks. And we're about to release the entire major and minor arcana, which is all 78 cards together, as a tarot deck that people can get and they can learn how to read it. And so if they're interested in that, I would go on to Kindred Spirits page and you can scroll down. You can see some posts about that tarot deck. It's called the Pixanka deck, like a picture, Pixanka, which is the name of the camp that my babcha was in. So the whole deck is about this journey of being an enslaved person to being a refugee and sort of the generations that come next. So I'm only I'm the third generation away.
Okay.
I'm not even really that far away. Like my mom's mother, right? Mm-hmm. My babcha was in the camp. So that's my real lived experiences, all the stories, everything, you know? So I had something to put it into. And all those ancestors come with that deck. And yeah, everybody who has this deck has had really interesting readings.
Okay.
RJ says it's the deck that reads you. And we're also...
I would say it's the only one that, it has been more than a deck that I've worked. I mean, I've worked with a few decks, you know.
What else do we have releasing? We only have a few minutes left. I don't want to...
Yeah, well, we have our Book of Stones.
Yeah,
Stone Medicine there, which is, a lot of people come to Kindred looking for, you know, their crystals or gemstones and things to help support their energetics. And so oftentimes, like, you know, you want to know what you're working with. And we're so big into education at Kindred. We want people to not just kind of... Like, we're not the type of spiritualist where you come to and, like, we pull a curtain back and we, like, you know, say we're doing something and open it and be like, okay, that's for you. Like, we like bringing people into the process and as much as we can. And
that's
also
what they want.
Yeah.
I mean, people want the knowledge.
And training them in a way. And okay. So we have a Book of Stones, which is being released with not only descriptions on, you know, the metaphysical and energetic properties of the stones, but how to work with them and what that whole – Antonina has done a beautiful job at kind of outlining the framework of – it's very quantum – in nature. So we have that we have a book release coming out this year as well, in addition to our Piedmont School of Herbalism, which is an online course. It's a 12-week course which Antonina has painstakingly compiled, which is an introduction into herbalism and using herbal medicines to support the mind, body, and spirit on that there. And so I know that it's going to be a timely release, especially with the whole COVID health crisis of it all. Like, yeah. I think it's so important right now to take your health into your to your own care and priority. And so we're going to be releasing that so people can use the indigenous natural tools to support their life and support their communities. And so lots of educational things coming down the pipeline.
The online course is very beautiful too. Like Jack Pennington of Green Sneakers Media filmed it for us.
Great job.
Was it last summer? Mm-hmm. It was last summer. Yeah, I was also grading standardized tests for the state of New Jersey or something at the time. And I was going to Greensboro and locking myself away in this little like room with all these other people in cubbies where we were just like clicking buttons to grade all these students' tests. And then at night I was teaching like the class. Wow. And I've taught the class for many years. It was the last in-person class I said I was going to teach for a while.
Yeah. Okay.
I've done a lot of those certs over the years, and we've done a lot of clinical work herbally too, and all that stuff's just kind of winding away.
CBD. Right. Well, man, I appreciate you guys coming by.
No doubt. It's good to be here.
Kindred Spirits was in the building when y'all in the city. If you're downtown, if you're not downtown, stop down and stop in. Give them the address again.
It's 537A. North Trade Street.
All right.
We have a big skull on the window. It's this beautiful painted deer skull. It's got all these crazy colors, so you cannot miss the front of the store. And on the other window, we have a giant, brightly colorful painting of Frida Kahlo. So either window, you're going to see bright colors.
So you got the address. You got the IG. Y'all go ahead and plug your personal IGs in so we can follow you on there as well.
Yeah. So you can find me at RJ underscore Walker on IG.
And I'm at Waples Antonina, which is at WHAPLESANTONINA. This is hard.
It's hard.
Yeah, y'all make sure y'all follow Pink Talk Podcast at Pink Talk underscore podcast.
Thanks
follow
for having us,
Faith.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, Miss Faith, we had an experience.
Pink Talk. Yeah.
Y'all follow my partner in crime, Coldplay Woo, Coldplay underscore Woo. And make sure y'all follow me, B underscore Bugatti, the host. And y'all definitely got to follow Open Media Lab, you know, because without them, it ain't no Pink Talk. So we need somewhere to get this good spirit right here in Winston-Salem, 24th floor, the Winston Tower.
I love it.
Y'all make sure y'all check us out. Mm-hmm. This is episode 14. Y'all stay COVID-free. Till the next time, we out.